The largest turtle in the world and the fourth largest reptile, it would be first except for some crocodiles, dang you crocodilians, is the leatherback sea turt. And it is absolutely enormous, as you are seeing right here. And what makes it really interesting is that you might think that a giant reptile like this, like many, most reptiles, is cold-blooded. Say it is ectothermic. It must receive heat from the environment to warm its body and warm its core. That's why you see giant lizards, iguanas laying out on rocks for so long when the sun is out, or why you need like a heating lamp if you had a reptile at home, like I did. I had a lot of reptiles growing up, and my snake escaped into the vents of the home. We're like, where is it? Oh, we found it again, but it took a while. What am I talking about? Right, ectothermy. They have to get heat from the environment. That's why you need something like a heating rock if you have reptiles at home. But what sets the sea turtle apart is that it's a gigantotherm. Oh, not only is that an awesome word, it means that the leatherback sea turtle is so big, it has so much mass in relation to how much surface area that it is, that it generates enough heat to maintain a stable body temperature as though it was an endotherm, like you humans are. It generates its own heat, and it can do that by constantly swimming throughout the frigid waters of the world's oceans, and the muscles heat the core, which is usually different in mammals and birds that have countercurrent heat exchangers. And I'm getting off track. Basically, I just wanted to tell you that gigantotherm is an awesome word for an awesome turt. Let's see a crocodile do that. Hello and welcome to Footnotes, the companion show to Because Science, where I take all of your comments, questions, and corrections and I hold them to my body for warmth because I am frigid inside. And then I tell you what's coming up next on this channel. Hint, you're gonna have to toss me a coin or I won't upload it. But getting right into it, in the last episode of Because Science, I was trying to teach you how to make a more realistic Sarlacc pit using engineering and physics. We went through the angle of repose. We went through size and density of particles to show that at certain angles, different materials have different avalanche angles, and that would make it more likely for anything stepping on the edge of the pit to slide down into a spiky maw. We also did that with frosted flakes, which I forgot are amazing. But I don't care about your choice in cereal. What I want to know is, what did you have to say aside from cereal stuff? Our first comment comes from Paul Mulkey, who says, if the Sarlacc was the larval stage of some ancient massive Tatooine dragonfly, that would be awesome. I agree. I think what people forget is that when an antlion, which is one of my favorite creatures, period, on this planet, when it actually matures into its less famous stage, it becomes this dragonfly-looking flying insect, and it is awesome, especially if you extend that to the Star Wars universe and you think about a 100-meter-long dragonfly flapping its wings. Its wings probably wouldn't be enough to support the mass it would be at and the bodies. It would be cool. I mean, if you go back and watch our Godzilla and Ghidorah episode, you know it probably wouldn't be able to fly, but a lot of things couldn't happen in Star Wars, like ending a trilogy satisfactorily. What am I, Reddit? Mike Berger Saunderson says, hey Kyle, love the show. Hey, just one question over here. What size grain of sand would be the best for this sort of mechanism? I imagine it wouldn't be the same sand if you're using sand from beaches in Mexico, very fine, or beaches in Massachusetts, very coarse. Plus, there is a size in which it just starts packing instead of keeping loose. Keep up the amazing work. Well, funny you should mention that. In one of the studies that I was referencing for this episode, the title of the study, if you're interested, is Effects of Slope and Particle Size on Antlion Locomotion, Implications for Choice of Substrate, which is a fancy word for like understuff by antlions. And their abstract here just concludes, antlion larvae preferentially built pits in the two finer sand size fractions, which means that the likelihood of ants falling down into the antlion trap was increased if the particle diameter size was much smaller, much finer, closer to something like flour as opposed to very coarse, large grain sand. So we could extend that out to the antlion and say that the antlion would want to find an environment, find some part of Tatooine or some other desert planet. There's a lot of desert planets in Star Wars. Why? Why would the whole planet be a desert? Danny Gregory says, my friends and I turned your video into a drinking game. Every time you said angle of repose, we took a shot. Needless to say, we got fairly drunk. No, you didn't, you liar. You know how I know? Because I did the math on you dum-dums. So Looking back in my script, I may have said it one or two extra times because I don't always adhere to the script perfectly. I said angle of repose 5 times in 11 minutes. And then if I go to the blood alcohol content calculator and say you had 5 shots in about 12 minutes, 11 or 12 minutes, and I assume you're an average weight for what age you look to be and what sex you look to be, then your blood alcohol content by the end of the video should have been 0.36%, which the blood alcohol content calculator says, you're probably not reading this because there's a good chance you're unconscious. This BAC indicates alcohol poisoning, and there's a very serious risk of long-term damage or death. If you or someone you're with may be at this BAC level, you should seek immediate medical assistance. You wouldn't have been even able... Am I drunk? You wouldn't even been able to post this comment because you might have been dead based on your body weight. So, stop lying in my comments. I won't have it. Also, drink responsibly, dum-dum. What are you doing? Nothing matters if you're not there to make things matter. Firm wrist. Peter O'Brien has a comment and says, I always enjoyed feeding antlions in Michigan. I would wait for an ant to come along and use a stick. I would fling them into the antlion's cone. The ant would struggle to get out and then the antlion would pull it under. Okay, kind of morbid, and common sense psychology has problems with people who feed animals to other animals and hurt small animals and stuff. But I gotta admit, a lot of you apparently did the same thing if you grew up near antlions. And I have to admit, I share a similar fascination with the interactions of insects. I used to find small bugs and stuff to put into spider webs. I used to put, okay, this is gonna sound weird, but I used to find those gigantic ant hills, like mounds, like human size, and I would rile them up with a stick so that, you know, hundreds, thousands of them were swarming on the surface, and then I would put my hand directly into it and wait for the maximum number of ants to be on my hand and bite me. I just wanted to feel something. But the nerdiest comment at the time I'm filming this episode, I'm giving to director of The Thing and Escape from New York, John Carpenter, who says, yeah, something I can comment on. I'm John Carpenter. I'm actually a material scientist, and my brother-in-law is an avalanche forester. Angle of repose is notoriously difficult to calculate because it depends on a combination of particle size, aspect ratio, rigidity, static friction, and density. That's assuming that these particles are even uniform. If you add in two different materials, like sand and dirt, it becomes an absolute nightmare. It's one of those properties that is wildly easier just to measure than it is to calculate. Calculating the avalanche angle for actual avalanches is far beyond that. John goes on to say how many different variables go in to the packing of snow, how it can accumulate on the sides of mountains and stuff, and concludes by saying, because of these properties on fluffy frozen water, determining an avalanche angle for actual avalanches is probably the hardest avalanche angle to determine. Whew. Oh yeah, love the show and your hair. Keep it up. You know what? You keep up your material sciencing and you tell your brother to keep up that avalanche foresting and tell him that you are now indeed a super nerd. Why didn't you direct The Thing? It's a really good film. I've only seen it like once though, because it scares me. But of course, I'm not always right. If you want proof of that, just watch our live streams on Fridays. I'm very often wrong. Not that often, sometimes. Okay, fine, you got me. So what did I get wrong last week? Oh, and if you want to correct me, as I'm sure you do, this is the internet, why don't you go back to the Because Science YouTube channel and like and subscribe and hit that notification bell so that whenever I do anything, you can be informed and alarmed. Ah, what? Like. Our first correction comes from Michael Baguette, wee wee, who says, hey Kyle, the show is awesome. I love all the nerdy conversations I get to have because of these topics. Hey. One question though, with all that sand collapsing back into the pit, at what point does the Sarlacc get full of sand? Oh wait, are you researching this as a guard for your secret lair? I see what you're doing, Interesting thought, but I think a creature such as a Sarlacc would have some kind of way to mitigate all the sand that it would accumulate as things fell into it. If it was evolved to do this, you would suspect that it would have some way of getting rid of the sand. The simplest way I can think of is just like excreting it, like a worm, that's the word, like a nightcrawler or a worm would do, which moves through the soil by ingesting it, moving it through its body segments, and then pooping it out the back. It kind of like just filters through the sand as it moves through. I could see some kind of biological process where the sarlacc would be able to separate sand from organic material or what have you in its gut, in its many chambered body, and then excrete the sand as some kind of sand poo. Parrotfish do something kind of similar to this. They use their beaks on their parrotfish faces and they chomp at the coral to get the algae growing on the coral, and then they poop out all the coral, and that poop coral ends up making the sand of the nice pearly white beaches. So next time you're on a beach, thank your local pooper. Is this a meme where everyone says love the show in the top part of the comment? You know, I'm fine with it. Our next correction comes from Philip Collier, or Collier, who says, another great show, Kyle, keep it up. Hey. Remember though, that ants can carry 50 times their body weight, so scaled up, an ant's exoskeleton is probably tougher than Mandalorian armor. I'm actually not so sure. I think this is a confusion because of this popular science fact that ants are stronger than their size implies. They can lift many times their own body weight. This is only because they are so small. When they have the volume that they do and how their muscles work, if you scale it down, because the cross-sectional area of an ant is what determines, like their arm, the cross-sectional area of that arm is what determines strength, and because their weight is determined by their volume, when you scale something down, because volume is cubed and surface area is squared, mass goes down a lot quicker than surface area. So at a certain point, something can be really tiny, but proportionately still very strong by being able to lift many times its own body weight. But if you scale that back up, the opposite becomes true, where at a certain size, your muscles won't even be strong enough to keep you standing. So a giant ant would not also be giantly strong. I hope that clears that up. Oh, it is a meme. Adam Bond says, requisite, hey Kyle, love the show, end quote. Hey, if you don't mean it, don't say it. Though I like to hear. Now that we've gotten that out of the, given that the sides of the pit of the sarlacc would be at an angle of repose and not straight up and down, wouldn't a sarlacc ball pit, which I tweeted about and we did a previous footnotes about, wouldn't that be better approximated by a cone? Adam goes on to calculate the total number of balls in that sarlacc cone, assuming a packing fraction, and gets about 840,000 balls. And that's a lot of balls. I think there might be some confusion here. I didn't make the ball pit itself the pit and then the mouth underneath. I made the ball pit the whole sarlacc. Like, you jumped into its mouth and the ball pit was its entire body. Then you get a couple million balls. But if you make a cone, if you make a sarlacc cone with a surprise hidden at the bottom for all those children who can't stop screaming at McDonald's, then yeah, I see your approximation. That makes sense. Where are your parents? Tis France's fault. Because when isn't it? Tis France's fault has a correction who says, sand dunes can be over 1,000 feet tall, Kyle, so they can get pretty tall, and then does this emoji. I said certain materials have certain angles of repose, and something like sand can never get that steep because of the grain size and all that, everything that we went through. France says that I've seen huge sand dunes. Well, yes, we've all seen planet Earth. There are also there are big sand dunes around, but though the sand dunes are tall, their slope is not very vertical. It still has that angle of repose. This distance can be like 1,000 feet or more, but the slope is still not very steep. That's what I was getting at. It's your fault, not France's. But the nerdiest correction at the time I'm filming this episode, I gotta give to Stefan Latimer, who says, howdy Kyle, I love the show and just recently watched Endgame so I could finally watch all the episodes you've ever made. Hey, thanks. They go on to say, you mentioned wet sand has a nearly 90 degree angle of repose and never talked about that contributing to sarlacc pit design. They go on to say that the angle of repose for sand might not be as big of a problem for a large humanoid creature. Presumably a sarlacc needs bigger creatures to feed itself than just like tiny, tiny ants relative to its size. And when you get to the size of something like a human, we can provide a lot of necessary downforce on the sand, even if it's at that avalanche angle, to get back out of the pit. Stefan suggests using moisture from those tentacles, tentacly speaking, to make it more like a sandcastle so you could build up even steeper walls with all that moisture from those tenties. And when a larger creature stepped on that material, they would tumble down more easily into the spiky maw. I think that's definitely possible, and I know this because if you do read the studies on antlions, they say that an organism has to be the correct size for the avalanche to work. Much, much larger ants than a certain size will be able to provide that downforce and escape the antlion's pit no problem. However, I will also say that these studies say that larger ants have a harder time escaping than smaller ants. So I think that if the sarlacc was a real creature that we could study, there probably would be some optimal size for a creature to fall down into it. Is that the size of a human, a Jabba the Hutt, a Boba Fetty? I don't know. But I like where your head's at, no matter if it's wearing a helmet. And for that, you are indeed a super nerd. Is The Mandalorian any good? Now, moving right along to this week's episode of Because Science. This week's episode of Because Science is, how does a Witcher's silver sword work? That's right, you all asked for more Witcher science because the show is dope and I am providing. How does a Witcher sword make itself the optimal monster fighting weapon for someone like Geralt of Rivia? What about the sword or the material itself could make it best at besting beasts? Oh, we go all into that. But before we get to slicing up elder vampires and drowners, please go watch the latest episode of Because Science if you haven't yet, all about Sarlacc pit science, and leave me your best, nerdiest comments, corrections, and questions at youtube.com/becauseScience, facebook.com/becauseScience, and at becauseScience on Instagram and Twitter. And don't forget, if someone doesn't like the something that you like, that's okay. Unless it's the season finale of Game of Thrones, am I right?